Are you confused by the should I, shouldn't I messages about wearing face masks during the COVID-19 pandemic? Hi, I'm Beth. I'm a medical student on the graduate entry program at the University of Birmingham. I'm going to be speaking to Professor KK Cheng, a professor of public health and primary care, over Zoom to try and answer some of the million questions we have about wearing face masks during the COVID-19 pandemic.
Hello.
Hi, KK. First of all, can I ask, what's your background and how has it informed your opinion on face masks?
I'm a public health doctor with an interest in epidemiology. Before COVID-19, I sometimes struggle to explain to my friends and relatives actually what epidemiologists do. But Now everyone seems to become an amateur epidemiologist. Yeah. But basically, we study the distribution and determinants of disease occurrence in human populations. And my interest in the past has focused a lot on chronic diseases, but we are all now dealing with COVID-19.
Yeah. Thank you. So the university recently asked its Instagram followers whether they wear face masks or not. Nearly 2,000 people responded to that survey, with 54% saying yes. Are you surprised by this result?
If we ask British respondents, I would have expected a slightly lower it's a positive rate, because if we look at the population use surveys that I've seen, yeah, really about 20-30% of people seem to be wearing masks. But So I expect that to be reflected in a survey that include mainly British respondents. But I suspect the sample that you've got includes some of our overseas graduates and so on.
Yeah, I agree. Because I've just seen people out in public. I haven't really seen too many people wearing face masks. So I was surprised for it to be so high. Some of the people said no because of the cost of face masks or availability of them. What's your thoughts on this?
Well, let me do the first thing to make it very, very clear is this. These are medical grade masks. Mm-hmm. Must be reserved for doctors and nurses and healthcare professionals.
Yeah, absolutely.
We should not go and grab the higher spec face mask that with the will to protect oneself.
Yeah.
These things have to be prioritized for our healthcare workers. But in the context of what we're talking about, wearing masks among the healthy individuals in the community.
Yeah.
Even homemade, very simple cloth mask, or even from kitchen towel, actually. There are lots of videos online. And if you're watching this from the UK, the British government has now got a video to sort of show you how to wear, how to make masks, and then how to remember when you wear a mask as well.
Yeah. Thank you for answering that one. So some of the people said the face masks have little effect in stopping the transmission of COVID. What do you think about this?
I don't think that's informed by science.
Yeah.
COVID-19 is a condition where there's a lot of asymptomatic transmission. By this, I mean that even before someone is symptomatic, if he or she is infected, there's actually already transmission before symptoms started. And these kind of transmissions can actually explain up to half of the cases that we see.
Yeah.
And we know that the main route of transmission is by droplets. And so something that basically physically block these droplets which come out of our airways when we speak, mm-hmm, or especially speaking loudly, or singing, actually. In people who are already infected but asymptomatic, has really very good mechanistic basis for how it works. And the other thing that makes me change my mind, because in early February, I was skeptic myself about the use of masks for preventing COVID-19.
Yeah.
But when I saw the evidence on asymptomatic transmission and also on the possibility of this called super spreaders. By super spreaders, I mean that actually fewer than 20% of infected individuals are actually accountable for almost 80% of all the cases of COVID-19. So, and some of them would be asymptomatic when they transmit, and that explains actually quite a large number of these of super spreaders, because if they're coughing already, most people would be self-isolating, I guess. Yeah. But they are asymptomatic or pre-symptomatic, and if they have, for example, a wide social circle, like to sort of have a lot of friends who they greet by hugging and kissing, and also by people who like to talk loudly. I'm afraid, actually, actually, in this age, I think, but talking loudly is probably not a very good idea either. Because we know that the main route is by droplet transmission. And things like washing hands is a mitigative measure after the droplets come off our airways and end on your desk or your keyboard. And then they call sort of fomites, and these are fomite contamination and infection. To prevent them, you do it by washing hands. And that's why it's important to wash hands.
And I guess that's why wearing masks combined with all the other techniques we've been told to implement, such as the social distancing and eye protection as well, all together, they're all going to make a difference.
There's no single magic bullet in this game. And each of them would contribute. If you ask experts from countries where the control is better or much better than the UK, if you ask the experts there, they would tell you, look, in our countries, we do a number of things, testing, tracing, isolation, social distancing, washing hands, masks. If you ask them, really, if you do the others, can you forget about masks? I think you struggle to find any experts to tell you that, really, as long as you look after the others, you don't really have to bother with masks.
Yeah.
It's actually impossible to disentangle between the roles of the different measures. But this has strong mechanistic evidence. And in this country, the government or scientific advisors of the government have taken the time to realize the importance of this. And I first wrote to the chief medical officer on 25th of February, and we wrote a letter in The Lancet published on the 3rd of March advocating the use of masks in this pandemic. But sadly, it wasn't heeded. But more and more countries have taken that on board. And the Royal Society of the UK, the most authoritative scientific body on the land, as they have a working group called DELF, which came out and support the scientific basis of masks.
That's really interesting to hear, thank you. So some people said that they don't think they're at risk, but judging by what you've just said about kind of the asymptomatic people that are spreading them, what's your thoughts on of what people have said?
Well, when people say they're not at risk, well, I don't know whether it means that they would not actually not risk of infecting others or not at risk of being infected. And if they're talking about the former, then because of this asymptomatic or pre-symptomatic transmission, there's no way of knowing. Yeah. And if it's the latter, then if you're at risk of being infected, let's say if you travel in a busy London underground train, or if you're from London, you know what I mean by the number 18 bus route. Actually, it's extremely busy in the morning. Yeah. And then everyone would be at risk if you actually are commuting in those environments. That's why the government has yesterday announced this requirement, making it mandatory for people who travel in public transport from the 15th of June to be wearing face covering.
Yeah, that's interesting. Thank you. And I guess just going looking through what other people have said, some people have said that they're not wearing them because the government haven't told them to, but now they are saying it. Do you think more people might wear them?
I sincerely hope so, because the government indeed in the last 2 months haven't been very supportive. When they asked, they were saying firstly no evidence, and then they say weak evidence, and then they say actually weak evidence that's of small effect. Mm-hmm. I don't think they're right with respect, actually, because 90 countries or more and the Royal Society believe it's useful. I know who I would believe in this. Actually, I think because of strong mechanistic basis,
yeah.
The government or their advisors were against it because there hasn't been clinical trials on the use of masks in this context,
mm-hmm.
which is absolutely true. But there are many things which you now practice that are not supported by clinical trials evidence. Cough etiquette. Mm-hmm. I can assure you there has never been a clinical trial to show that if you do this when you cough, it's actually effective in preventing infection. Social distancing, what's the clinical trials between 1.5 meter and 2 meter? Where is the trial? Actually, there's absolutely no clinical trial that's done that. And one often quoted example is parachute. Do you need a clinical trial to show that if you jump out of a plane at 15,000 feet, having a parachute is better than not having a parachute?
Yeah. No, that's, you make a really interesting point there. That's thank you. One final thing, Professor Cheng. I know that your hope is that everyone will start wearing face masks in the UK and indeed in the world. But what's one key message that you'd like people to remember from this video and this chat that we've had today?
I think actually, if you are going out in public, especially in crowded places where social distancing is impossible, believe scientific authorities and almost all health ministries in the world. Wear a mask, protect each other. You wear a mask, protect me. I wear a mask, protect you.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually an act of altruism and an act of solidarity.
Yeah, that's really interesting. And I suppose if we all kind of think we have the virus and think everyone else does too, that kind of sticks in your mind of why we're doing all of these things to protect ourselves and protect everyone else. Thank you very much for your time today, Professor Cheng. It's been really interesting to hear your opinions, and I hope that people do learn some things from what you've said today.
Thank you, Beth.